Islam or try, you don't want to become a Muslim. So I got an opportunity to study a study abroad program, University of Nairobi in Nairobi, Kenya. After having been there for maybe about a week or so, I went to the mosque and I told the imam, who's the preacher, that I wanted to be a Muslim. And so I officially converted there, and probably shortly after that, maybe about 6 months after that, I got a chance to make the pilgrimage to Mecca. And so that way I was able to see the big picture. I guess I was about 24 years old when that happened. And then I came back to the States, I got my doctor's degree, and landed a job at Tennessee State, and initially in the sociology department. And then, of course, I established the Africana Studies Department some years later in 1994. And I built that department over a period of about 15 years. And then I retired from the university maybe about 5 years ago. And so that's pretty much, you know, my story. Dr. Baldwin and I co-authored a book entitled Between the Cross and Christian and Muslim Perspectives on Malcolm and Martin, where we both try to work out our respective religious biographies as well as the religious biographies of Malcolm and Martin.
Very good. And so you've been involved in what we're going to talk about today for a long time.
Yes.
And you've had some real thoughts in reference to it. And yes, you come from a background that people would not ordinarily associate with you being involved in the religion that you're involved in. Is that essentially what you're saying in terms of your religious background, et cetera?
So,
nobody would have thought that a black man from Birmingham, Alabama, would be eventually become one of the most important scholars in a real sense dealing with Islam in the United States, as you are. And what we'll do, Dr. Al-Adid, as we make preparations for our first commercial break, we'll come back and we'll give you an opportunity to use the knowledge that you have to inform our people in reference to Islam in the United States at the 21st century. We've had you on, as we indicated earlier, dealing with this topic, but I think that so much has happened over the last few years in reference to Islam, and some things are going on in Egypt today that you can probably enlighten us on in reference to it. And so when we come back for the second segment, I want you to use that experience and some of the current things that are going on in the world today dealing with Islam and to bring our audience up to date as to how that is viewed at the 21st century. And we'll be back with our audience following this very, very short commercial break. Thank you, and welcome back to the second segment of the show for today. We're talking to Dr. Al-Adid, who has given us some information in reference to his background and some of the things that have played very, very significant parts in his earlier career dealing with Islam. And of course, Dr. Al-Adid, let's pick up where we left off the last time, because I think that what we're trying to do is to look at Islam in the 21st century in the United States. And so from your perspective, let's talk about that.
Yes. Well, first thing I'd like to say, Ramadan Mubarak to all of the Muslims around the world that are currently fasting in Nashville. This is our eighth day of fasting. You know, Islam is probably one of the most misunderstood religions in America, and might be one of the most misunderstood religions on the planet, especially in a post 9/11 world. And as before we could really get our balance back, you know, you had this thing that happened at the Boston Marathon, you know, which has exacerbated, you know, the whole situation. So let me give your viewing audience an idea of what Islam is, because so many people have their definition of what it is and their perspective on. Well, Islam is a very simple and natural religion. That's first of all. It comes out of the Abrahamic traditions, which means that it is a sister religion to Judaism and Christianity. Now, Judaism and Christianity all go back to Abraham, but through his first wife, Sarah, that's created the Jewish nation or the Israelites, okay? Now, Abraham took a second wife by the name of Hagar, who was an Egyptian. And out of that marriage came a son by the name of Ishmael. In the Bible, the people refer to as the Ishmaelites. And the Ishmaelites are the Arabs of the Arabian desert. So out of that line came our prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. So you have these three religions all coming from a shared patriarch, Abraham. Now, what does Islam actually stand for? If you go to the Ten Commandments, the first commandment of the Ten Commandments is, "Thou shalt have no other God before me." Well, that's the first article of faith in Islam. We just, in Arabic, in the Islamic way of thinking, we just simply say that I bear witness there's no God but Allah. That's the same thing that the Jewish people say when they say that "Thou shalt have no other God before me." So there's this idea that both religions, Judaism and Christianity, are diametrically opposed to anyone associating partners or associates with God, that God is one. And then in extension of that, we say that our prophet Muhammad is the last and final messenger. And what are we saying here? We're simply saying that Prophet Muhammad is a continuation of the prophetic chain that in our theology goes all the way back to Noor, who is Noah, coming down to Moses, coming down to Jesus, and going through all of the prophets. And so we're saying that all of the prophets taught total submission to the will of God. What does Islam mean? That's exactly what it means. Islam means that you submit your finite will to the infinite will of your creator, of God, right? And that means total submission to the will of God. So the first article of faith in Islam is to bear witness that there's no God except Allah and that Muhammad is his last and final messenger. Now, like all other religions, we have prayer. We pray five times a day, and our prayer is regulated by the positions of the sun. The first prayer is at first light, which is dawn. We call it in Arabic the Fajr prayer. And then when the sun goes all the way up to its highest point and starts to decline, we have a second prayer called the Dhuhr prayer, which is the noon prayer. And then maybe about 2 hours after that, we have the afternoon prayer called the Asr prayer. And then at sunset, we have our fourth prayer, which is the Maghrib prayer. And then by 2 hours after sunset, we have the fifth prayer, which is the Isha prayer. And the cycle starts all over again. And sometimes, in what we call the second midnight, you can pray, after midnight. Our third pillar of faith is charity. Now, all religions that I know of, Christianity, Judaism, Buddhism, Hindu, they have some form of charity. And our charity, we pay 2.5% of our income back to society. Muhammad Ali once had a famous quote. He said, "Charity is the rent that you pay for your place on earth." So we always have to be empathetic and sympathetic with the poor. We want to give back. The fourth pillar is what we are doing now. This is the month of Ramadan, which is the ninth month of the Islamic calendar. And during this period of fasting, first of all, in order to start the fasting, we have to sight the new moon visually. And once we see that new moon, then we start fasting. You can't eat, drink, or engage in lawful conjugal relationships with your spouse until the sun sets. So you're fasting without drinking anything, without eating anything, from dawn to sunset. Now, after the sun sets, you are free to eat or drink what you would normally eat or drink and to actually go back to your normal life. Then the cycle starts over. And this goes on for 1 month. And during this month, we are strongly encouraged to recite a part of the Quran. The Holy Quran is divided into 30 parts, and each day we are to recite 1/30th of the Quran. This part is called a juz, so we'll recite that. And right now, we are at the 11th part of the Quran. The Quran is the book that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad, as the Torah was revealed to Moses, as the New Testament was revealed to Jesus. And so that's our holy book. So we have to believe in all of the books that came before us. We have to believe in all of the prophets that came before us. And the fifth pillar of Islam is the pilgrimage to Mecca. And I think a lot of our viewing audience might know about the narrative that Malcolm X gave when he went to Mecca and he saw all of these people from different cultures, different nationalities, different colors, different languages, all coming together in a common humanity. And I'm often reminded of something that Dr. Martin Luther King said, which is so powerful. He said that we all tied together in a single garment of destiny, mm-hmm. in an inescapable network of mutuality. Mm-hmm. What affects one directly affects all indirectly. So we are all one human family. And we have to learn, as a human family, how to get along, mm-hmm. how to form relationships with each other, how to do trade and commerce, fair and reasonable trade and commerce with each other, and how to get along, because we just is one planet. Mm-hmm. We are one blood. We come from the same genetic pool. We come from the same DNA. We are human beings. And so we have to learn to love each other and respect each other.
Very good. And of course, Dr. Elodie, let us take this second commercial break, okay. and then we'll come back and we'll pick up at that point and we'll get into some other aspects of the religion in mm-hmm. the 21st century. And very we'll good. Be back with our audience following this very, very short commercial break. Thank you and welcome to this final segment of the show for today. We're talking to Dr. Al Hadid, who has given us some information in reference to Islam in the United States at the 21st century. And he has given us an excellent review in terms of religions in the United States and especially religions in the world. And Dr. Al Hadid, let's pick up during this final segment and to talk about the impact that Islam has had upon the United States during the 21st century, or mm-hmm. As the 21st century emerges? Mm-hmm.
Well, let's look at it from a global standpoint. To start off demographically, there are approximately 1.5 billion Muslims on the earth. Most Muslims external to the United States are concentrated on two continents, Asia and Africa. Inside of the United States, the estimates vary, but I think the most accurate estimate is probably that there are anywhere between 7 and 10 million Muslims inside of the United States. Of those 7 to 10 million Muslims, approximately 50% are African Americans. So we say maybe about 5 million African American Muslims, and then 5 million Muslims who are of immigrant descent. Some immigrants, however, are born in the United States, but I'm talking about descent in terms of where their parents came from, you know. And so you classify the African American Muslim as indigenous Muslims to that extent, and then the other group would be the immigrant Muslims, even though, as I said earlier, some of the immigrants are born here, mm-hmm. so that would also make them indigenous, mm-hmm. but I'm talking more from a historical level, mm-hmm. because you can trace the presence of African American Muslims in the United States all the way back to slavery, mm-hmm. and then you can trace the presence of African Muslims in this part of the world before Columbus. Mm-hmm. You know, you had people, Mansa Musa, for example, from the Mali Empire, sent a group of people out on the ship. Mm-hmm. He sent maybe about 200 ships out to explore this area before Columbus. Mm-hmm. and it was the actual travel documents of these people that went out before Columbus that Columbus actually used to plot his course and come in this part of the world. And as a matter of fact, some of his navigators on the his various ships were Muslims who had already traveled to this part of the world. So it wasn't that Columbus discovered the New World. It had already been discovered. And he was the one that got discovered once he came over here, you see, because Muslims were already over here. When Columbus got here, there were mosques in Cuba. There were mosques in Brazil. And so what happened, Columbus' explorations into this part of the world was nothing more, if you will, than an extension of the Spanish Inquisitions. All right, so in other words, he was coming to this part of the world to ferret out the Moors that he had been dealing with for the Spanish had been dealing with the Moors in Spain for 700 years. You know, Islam came out of North Africa and went into Spain, where it was in Spain for 700 years. And it started, I mean, if you want to look at it, you can say that the presence of the Moors in Spain was a catalyst that sparked the European Renaissance that brought them out of the Dark Ages, you see. So, and then we could also say, then, you know, you had the slave trade that started, and the slave trade was nothing more than a continuation of the Crusades and the Spanish Inquisitions. So that getting back inside of the United States, you know, we've always had Muslims coming up from slavery. You've had people like Omar Said, you've had people such as Ibrahim Asari. These people, when they came over, they had many of them had memorized the entire Quran. They could speak and write Arabic as well as their own languages, whether that was Hausa or Mandinga or Wolof. They were highly educated people. They were scholars, you know, and translators in their own world. Some of them were legal scholars. They had studied what we call the Sharia, which is Islamic law. And so they came out well established. They were merchants. They were soldiers. So when they came to America, they were just not manual labor. These were people who were skilled craftsmen and intellectuals and scholars, and they could read and write, which is what most of the Europeans over here could not do. Most of the people who were plantation overseers and why they came out of Europe, and illiteracy was very high. See, in Europe during the period when Muslims were at the highest point, only 5% of the people in Europe could read and write. And most of the people in Europe that could read and write were directly connected with the Vatican or some church establishment because they needed to be able to do the Latin and the Greek and so forth. So the literate people were the royal family, and the literate people were the people who were connected with the, you know, the Catholic Church and the Church of England, et cetera. But the masses of the people could not read and write. So when these Muslims are coming over here, they can read and write in Arabic, they can read and write in Hausa, they can read and write in Fulani, you know, they got to do something about these people. And so that's what the Middle Passage was really all about, stripping these people of their knowledge of self and kind, their knowledge of their culture, you know, and their civilization. So that when we look at Islam in the 21st century, we have to look at Islam against that backdrop. So let's go to the year 1965, which I think for Islam was a very pivotal year, because that was the period where the immigration laws changed and the Americans allowed more people from the Muslim world to come to the United States, from Turkey, from Syria, from Iraq, from Lebanon and other places like that. Now, what happened, as you know, the Ottoman Empire collapsed after World War I. Because it actually was an empire that started in the 7th century in Arabia and developed all the way up to World War I. So you had one Islamic empire, if you can imagine, from the 7th century all the way up to World War I. And the reason that the Ottoman Turkish Empire collapsed is because they got on the side with Germany.
The wrong side
of
the war.
They were on the wrong side of the war. Mm-hmm. They sided with Germany rather than getting with England. Mm-hmm. Had they gotten with England, then the empire would not have collapsed. Mm-hmm. So it's because of the fact that